Good morning. Welcome. I am Christy. I am a pastoral intern here at Crosswinds, and I just am thankful to be here with you this morning. If you are new today and first time visiting us, I just want to let you know our senior pastor, Stina Kappas, is not here with us. She's enjoying a few days off, much deserved time off, so I do hope you will come back and meet her in the future. And then also, she actually might be watching online. We could probably say hello to her. but for those watching online, we welcome you too and are thankful that you are worshiping with us this morning. It's going to be a good morning. We have our band, Wind in the Spirit, leading worship today. And so I'll go ahead and let our leaders call us to worship. That's right.
Please stand and join us in the call of worship. Jesus had confidence in life after death. That confidence can be ours.
The grief felt at Lazarus' death was overcome by the reassurance of Jesus.
He said, "I am the resurrection and the life."
In raising Lazarus, Jesus demonstrated that death is not beyond the hope found in resurrection.
We are strengthened in our faith by the mighty acts of Jesus.
We are given courage and confidence by the power of God to overcome our worst fears. Amen.
Please sing Our God with us.
Oh, God.
be seated.
Will you pray with me? Good and gracious God, we come before you so grateful to be in your presence. Lord, you are our Redeemer. You are our Comforter. You are the Giver of new life. We praise you and we praise your holy name. Your name is above all names. Lord, we are thankful to come to you in prayer, to be in your presence, to be heard and seen and cared for by you. And in these moments of quiet meditation, Lord, we pray that you would hear the ponderings of our heart, the longings, the losses, and the laments, and the pleas. Good God, we thank you. We thank you again for hearing us and seeing us, being with us in our grief, in our pain, where we feel stuck. Lord, you breathe your spirit into us and give us new life. We are so grateful. Lord, we lift up to you now the heartbreak that's taking place in the southern part of our country, where tornadoes have hit and caused devastation and destruction for the people of Mississippi and Alabama. Lord, we pray that you would lead them in the recovery, in the rebuilding. Lord, we pray over this war in Ukraine. We pray for peace. We pray for your mighty intervention. We pray for the landslides in California, the fear and terror that people must be feeling. Lord, we pray that you would be with them. We pray in our own backyards to the people of Monticello who are threatened by this nuclear leak. We pray for your protection and for your guidance. And Lord, we pray for our country, for the relationships that are at stake here as we look towards this new election season. Lord, we pray for your constance and your steadiness and your steadfast love to hold us and guide us. And now let us pray as Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Please stand and join us. Please be seated.
At this time, the children can head downstairs with Miss Alyssa for the children's message. All children are invited to meet Alyssa in the back of the sanctuary. They will return to the sanctuary before the end of the service.
Good morning. I'm glad to be with you all this morning on this fifth Sunday of Lent. Next week begins Holy Week with the start of Palm Sunday, and it will be a celebratory morning here at Crosswind, so I do hope you will come back and join us. This Lenten season, Pastor Stina has been leading us in a series called Miraculous, where we've been focusing on different miracles that Jesus performed during his ministry. And today we have one of the most well-known and beloved stories in all of the Bible, the story of Lazarus being raised from the dead. And I'm going to read to you the passage, but before I do, I want to situate the story for you a bit. It's from John's Gospel, and the story of Lazarus isn't just a story, it's a defining moment. In ancient Greek writings, significance was placed on the form of how the writing was written, and I'm not going to bore you with the details, but I just want to point out that the location of the story in John's Gospel puts it right smack dab in the middle of his writing. And so to the Greek Jews that would have been reading this, it would have been significant, and it would have stood out as a culminating point in the story. So the raising of Lazarus is the last of seven miracles that John uses in his gospel to point his readers towards Jesus's divinity and messiahship. And it's also a pivotal point in Jesus's life. It's after the raising of Lazarus that the religious elite shift from merely not liking him and causing him trouble to making a formal decision to have him killed. So contextually, this story is the beginning of the end of Jesus's teaching and ministry and earthly life. Outside of using biblical scholarship to analyze this passage, there are messages of hope and new life. And we're going to draw upon that this morning. So let me read to you from the Gospel of John. We're in chapter 11, verses 32 through 44. When Mary reached the place where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and said, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping and the Jews who had come along with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. "Where have you laid him?" he asked. "Come and see, Lord," they replied. And Jesus wept. Then the Jews said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" Jesus, once more deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. "Take away the stone," he said. "But Lord," said Martha, the sister of the dead man, "by this time there is a bad odor, for he has been there 4 days. Then Jesus said, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. Then Jesus looked up and said, "Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I said this for the benefit of the people standing here, that they may believe that you sent me." When he had said this, Jesus called in a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out." The dead man came out, his hands and feet wrapped with strips of linen and a cloth around his face. And Jesus said to them, "Take off the grave clothes and let him go." We are a resurrection people. Resurrection is our heritage. Resurrection and new life are central to our faith and how we make meaning. But we can't experience resurrection and new life without death. And death doesn't come without pain and grief. And grief is something none of us want to go through. Grief is something we grapple with. Our hearts and minds and bodies don't want to go through the work of grief. I'm sure you've heard of the five stages of grief: denial, anger, bargaining, depression, and acceptance. Going through this emotional work is painful, and it requires so much of ourselves. It also requires support from our community. And we see this going on in the text. In Jewish tradition, visiting and consoling the bereaved was an essential, pious duty. When a loved one died, they would bury them that same day, and the closest neighbor would come and provide the meal after the burial. And then that first week of deep grief, the family would sit what's called Shiva. And this meant that they would spend the week mourning in their home, sitting on the floor, and their friends would come and visit them. And this is what's happening with Mary and Martha. They're sitting Shiva. And it's still a practice today in Judaism. And it's found to be very helpful in releasing grief. And we all have our traditions that we find comfort in. In fact, every culture in the world has traditions surrounding death and grief. And my family is from the South, so I can sum up the traditions that I'm accustomed to in one word, food. About 12 years ago, my grandma and my uncle, her son, died within a matter of days from each other. And their deaths were not linked in any way. They were both, we were shocked. We were not expecting their passing at all. And so my family traveled to Kentucky, and we stayed with my aunt during that time, as you do when you have family that died. And I will never forget, there was a neighbor of my grandmother's that would come and visit us pretty much every day, and she would sit in the living room. And I remember looking around, and I was taking in all the food that had been brought to the house. And she must have seen my face, but she said, "Oh, honey, they aren't going to cook for 3 months." And I don't think they did. I honestly don't. I mean, they just, their neighbors and community cared for them in this way, and it brought them comfort. And these traditions bring us comfort during these difficult times, right? What I find comforting in this passage is the honesty in which their grief is grappled with and expressed, and how Jesus responds. We see some blame going on here. Is there anyone a blamer? Can anyone identify with that? Blaming is a natural human reaction. When we're experiencing deep pain and loss, we want someone to take responsibility for our hurt or for a wrongdoing and an injustice. And we see it happening here with Mary. Mary is upset. And as gentle as she is, make no mistake, she is blaming Jesus for her brother's death. And she's not alone. Those gathered with her to grieve are also blaming Jesus. Jesus was a well-known healer in that area, and he was their dear friend. And earlier in this chapter, it's told that they had sent word to him, to Jesus, that Lazarus was dying, and it was asking him to come. And he didn't come right away. They had seen him heal a blind man. They had all the faith in the world that Jesus could have healed Lazarus. So to them, Jesus' death is a direct result. I'm sorry, Lazarus' death is a direct result of Jesus' choice not to come right away and not to heal. He was to blame. Have you ever blamed God for your pain? For not showing up how you wanted, or for not bringing healing that you've so desperately prayed for? I think it's interesting what Jesus does when he's blamed and he's questioned. He receives it. He doesn't get defensive or angry with them. Instead, he joins their grief and he weeps. This poignant moment reveals so much about God's love for us and his desire to be with us, to be with us in our pain and in our suffering. He alone knows that resurrection's around the corner, but he leans into the essential work of grief. Our grief matters to God. God can't take away our grief. Even in this story, Lazarus will be raised from the dead, but he will die again. And those that love him will grieve all over again. God can't take away our grief and our loss, but he knows it intimately. He knows the fullness of what death does. Whether it's the actual death of a loved one, or the end of a relationship, or just a life event that's changing everything we know, God understands, and his choice is to grieve with us and to weep. And this validates our own desires to yearn for life, to want to cling to this beautiful world and feel a sense of wrongness and injustice in the face of death. It is okay to mourn the loss of vitality or intimacy or longevity. It is okay to love and to cherish the gift of life here and now. We are resurrection people. Resurrection is our heritage. And resurrection and new life are essential to our faith and how we make meaning. But how do we go from death and grief to new life? Is it through our own belief? I would say no. I don't think it is. The story of Lazarus shows us it has nothing to do with our ability to believe or to have vision for what's to come. If you go back to the story, did you notice that no one in attendance believes in Jesus' power to resurrect Lazarus from the dead? Even Martha, who had believed in his power to heal, informs Jesus, "It's too late. Too many days have passed. He is dead." And there's no one in the crowd that expects a dead man to emerge. To them, death is final, irrevocable. There's no remedy for it. What in your life is feeling final or irrevocable? What is there no remedy for? Are you experiencing a death, a loss, or are you stuck? Is it your faith? Does it need new life breathed into it? I want you to know that your ability to believe is not the source of resurrection or new life. It is Jesus. It is his oneness with God that is the source. We cannot come with ready-made belief. God alone gives us the power to believe. It is Jesus that creates the ability to believe by turning death to life over and over and over again. It was those watching and unbinding Lazarus as he emerged from the grave that were given vision and the ability to believe. It is not something we can muster. It is a gift from our good and gracious God. Resurrection is our heritage, and it is Jesus' purpose and mission to bring life to us, fullness of life. And we often hear of resurrection, we think of a distant promise or a guarantee for salvation or eternal life with God and Jesus in heaven. And while I hold true the hope of eternal life, that's not what we're talking about here. We aren't describing a future salvific existence. We're talking about life here and right now with Jesus. The gospel doesn't describe Lazarus's future or eternal life, but the present one. In the fullest sense. There are two things I want to point out about resurrected life before I wrap up and let you all go on your Sunday morning. The first is resurrected life starts in community. Jesus called Lazarus, but told others to unbind him and to let him go. Resurrected people require caring communities that are willing to nurture and strengthen them until they are able to walk alone. If you're a part of Alcoholics Anonymous or another recovery group, you know that community is the foundation in which you build a sober life upon, a new life upon. And when we are in these times of transition going from death to life, we need one another to help remove the grave clothes of self-doubt and isolation. We need help tearing away the wrappings of fear and anxiety and loss and grief, so that when we are unbound, we can walk in dignity. We can be creative agents in this world. The burial clothes that bound Lazarus's feet and hands and face were vivid reminders that death still clung to him. He needed others to care for him during that process. The other point I wanted to make was that a resurrected life is made up of a close relationship with Jesus. If we look forward to the next chapter in the book of John, it's chapter 12, if you want to look it up, we see a picture of the fullness of abundant life, the intimacy in which Lazarus is living life with Jesus. They gather around a table and dine and lounge together in closeness. Lazarus reclines on Jesus' chest. It's a picture of an intimate and close relationship. After Lazarus' resurrection, he spends time with God in the flesh. He lingers with Jesus. If you are in a space of grief or if you're experiencing a death of any sort, or if you're simply stuck and having trouble to see what new life or new future may be for you, my desire for you is that you will take hope, that you will know God's power resides with us in our grief, in our stuckness, even if we can't see it or recognize it. Have hope that God does the work of giving us new life. God does the work of enabling us to believe. God calls us to God's self and to life anew. Resurrection is God's realm. Let us rest in the hope of possibility, even where we don't see it. Let us yearn for resurrection and the unbinding that releases us so we can dream beyond the boundaries and we can experience life anew. And let us know the fullness of abundant life, of knowing and reclining into a life with Jesus. Amen. We have some announcements for you all. As I mentioned earlier, Holy Week starts next Sunday, April 2nd, and we have a variety of services planned for you all that we are hoping you will come join us with. The first one being Palm Sunday. It will be a family-friendly event. There will be a children's palm parade, so make sure you bring your little ones that you love. And then on Thursday, April 6th, we will have a Maundy Thursday service at 1 in the afternoon. This one won't be streamed online. You'll just need to come here for it. But it will be a time of prayer and communion. And it'll be more of an intimate service. And then Good Friday, on April 7th, we will have a 7 o'clock service. And that will be more of a somber meditative service where we'll meditate on the crucifixion of Christ. And then Easter morning, we will have a celebration. We'll start with a continental breakfast. As you know, many of you know, our kitchen is being built for us. It's not quite ready. So the hospitality group has done an amazing job of pulling together a continental breakfast that we'll enjoy together at 9, and then worship will be at 10 o'clock. So we hope that you will come and join us. And then Janine, I'll invite up to talk about our kitchen shower.
You might think I'm a little premature wearing my apron, but if you've looked in Fellowship Hall, you know the kitchen is coming right along. I brought one of my favorite cookbooks. It's from our previous church called Burnt Offerings. So you never know what's gonna happen in that new kitchen. We're grateful for everyone's help. During the construction, there's so many people who have shared their time and talents with us to get that kitchen up and running. So as we get ready to open, you'll see that there is going to be a kitchen shower on April 30th after worship. And so we'll have lunch, there'll be shower games, and have a lot of laughs. And then in the spirit of an old-fashioned shower, we have a registry built, so you can donate money towards a specific item. You might want to buy silverware, you might want to buy some pots and pans or some wooden spoons, or you can donate just to the greater good, and the kitchen management team will purchase all the items and make sure that kitchen is ready to open when it's time. So stop by, you'll see the aprons hanging out in the back. Stop by and you can go online and donate. You can learn about the registry there. And hope to see you on the 30th for the kitchen shower. Thanks.
Thanks, Janine. And now Craig is going to tell us about a blood drive.
All right. Every 2 seconds, someone in the U.S. needs blood. Giving blood is crucial to save people's lives by making sure blood is available when it's needed. Donating is safe and simple. While the process is quick for the donor, it may make a lifetime difference for others. Be a hero and give blood. When you give, others live. Crosswinds would like to host a blood drive on Saturday, June 3rd. In order to secure our spot, we'll need 30 volunteers and sign up as donors. Please sign up by March 28th. There's a QR code in the bulletin today. There's one in the back of the narthex, and also you can find one how to register just as to be a donor online on the new church website. Thank you.
Come up.
Josh and Jenny to join me.
Do you want your microphone?
I'm kind of loud enough without one, I think, but I know it helps. It's my privilege this morning to first publicly thank you for your service to Crosswinds. Today is Josh and Jenny's last Sunday with us. But in the fall of 2021, God's Spirit nudged you, Josh, and Jenny to radically pursue transformation. In that call, the two of you answered the invitation to return to Minnesota. Together, you gathered your pups, you piled into a U-Haul, and you braved snowstorms. Imagine that. And you trekked across the country, and you have leaned into transformation. Josh, you joined our staff as the Director of Youth Ministries, and Jenny accepted a position with Onamia Hospital. And we were doubly blessed because we got not only Josh, but Jenny, as she frequently joined us and served in support of our youth. And together, the two of you gifted us with your presence, with your commitment to faith, a quiet and gentle grace, a love of study and scripture, and some good hearty fun and laughter thrown in the middle of it. As I recall, some costumes of food were involved in part of it. And the transformation continued. We are so grateful for your commitment and leadership to not only the youth and their families, but also to the entire community of Crosswinds. We also honor that God is at work, not only here at Crosswinds in transformation, but also in your personal lives. And that sometimes means our journeys take new paths. Transformation isn't always easy. Josh and Jenny, we want to thank you for sharing yourselves with us for the past nearly 2 years. We also want to bless you forward as your lives shift and you move into the new spaces that God is calling you to. So I invite the two of you to hold your hands open. And I invite the congregation and all those present, including those who are joining us online, to raise your hands out as an open offering of blessing as I pray. Heavenly and miraculous God, we thank you for Josh and Jenny. We're grateful for their love, for their commitment, and their service to you and to our Crosswinds community. Bless, guide, and direct them as they move forward in life, seeking to continue to serve you in new ways. And the people said, amen. Again, I thank you both. I do invite the congregation to connect with Josh and Jenny and enjoy some treats in their honor following the service out in the center area. And if you're unable to stay, or you are watching this online and you want a chance to reach out to them, please connect with the church office and let them know, and we will help make that happen because they are coordinating getting cards and messages to them, and we bless them as they finish out this time with us this next week. So thank you. And before I turn things back over to our worship leaders, I do get the pleasure of offering one more staff update. It pays to hang around when the pastor and the chair of SPRC are gone traveling, because I got to make these announcements. So it's pretty fun. It is my honor today to announce to you that it is Bishop Plumbeck's intention to appoint Christy Sterlikson to Aldersgate United Methodist Church in St. Louis Park, effective July 2nd.
That's right. Thank you.
Christy's last Sunday with us will be April 23rd, so we do have a few more weeks before she begins her transition, but we're excited to celebrate this milestone in your ministry. Congratulations, Christy.
Thanks, Becky. Appreciate it. And now we're going to take our offering. Do we have a slide? There we are. There are several ways to give, but before I talk about that, I just want to talk about how generous this community has been in sustaining this ministry of Crosswinds. We've been talking about the kitchen, which is a huge, huge new thing, and that you all have funded, and we're so grateful. And we also have a new website up. If you haven't gone onto Crosswinds website, I invite you to do so. It's beautiful. But it's your resources that have helped us do this. So again, there are ways to give online through text, or you can also mail, cash or check, or there's also some offering plates at the end of the tables there on your way out if you'd like to drop in that way. But we just are so grateful for your consistent blessing to this ministry in your time and your talents and your treasures. So will you pray with me over this offering? Good and gracious God, we thank you for the many ways that you have blessed Crosswinds, that you continue to sustain us, and that you also continue to guide our ministries. Lord, we lift up this new website and this kitchen that's getting built and all of the other ministries that we have going on, that you would just breathe new life into them, that you would show us how you want to use them to bless the communities and bless our world, Lord. We thank you again for your constants in our lives and to this church. In Jesus' name, amen.
Please stand and join us for the closing blessing. Lord, unbind us from our fears and doubts. As we go from this place of worship, be with us in our witness to the power and love of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Please join us in this very joyful closing song.
will cry, "Hail the Lamb, who slain for the world, ruling high." And the earth will reply,
thank you for worshiping with us today. Please stay and join us in the fellowship time. We'll see you next week for Palm Sunday worship at 10 a.m. in person, streaming, or online anytime. Have a wonderful week, everyone.
Cry, hey.